going to keep this as short and sweet as possible, given that we've run over time. And we've got an interesting mix of people today with me. So I've got Maha, Abayazid, who's the Director of Investor Relations with Kempinski, Graham Howard, who's Director of Hospitality and Gaming with United Africa Group, and Shamil Manek, who's Executive Director of the Merwest Company, who recently had done the two Four Points by Sheraton in Nairobi. So I think we're just going to discuss hopefully some interesting topics around the whole owner-operator structuring piece and building a relationship that makes sense for both parties. I know it's something that's discussed at all these things, but you know, we've got a bit of a different mix today, and let's see if we can make it interesting. So we're going to start with ladies first. I know we're all a little bit tired after last night, Maha, but you're an interesting brand because you're a single brand operator. How do you find that works with building relationships with your investors?
Okay, so when Kempinski started in 1897, we started as a family business. And since then, and we are actually celebrating our 120 years anniversary, we have always been the oldest European independent hotel company. We currently operate 76 properties in 30 different countries, but our strategy has always been to be independent. We have only one brand, which is the Kempinski brand, and this strategy is not going to change in the near future. As such, having just 76 properties around the world, we managed to have very personalized relationship with our owners, existing and new.
And I mean, I'm going to move on to Shamil, who's operating in a slightly different space as an owner, and an owner who isn't operating in the luxury space, at least yet. You know, having a single brand Kempinski, they're more focused on the relationships with their investors. They're obviously not necessarily as focused on loyalty programs and things like that as a single brand operator with a limited number of properties. But for you as an owner, loyalty programs with the brands, is that something that you look at quite extensively?
Yeah, so basically when we were looking at for a brand, for our properties, I wouldn't say loyalty brands was a it was more of a cherry on top. It wasn't something that we were gung-ho about, but especially with such a brand like at the time Starwood and now SPG and Marriott merging, it's definitely given us a huge growth path, a huge pipeline of customers. It's definitely something that we looked at and we considered in the fact that how do we tap into this to make our business more successful and grow? We have to fill 300 beds a night in Nairobi right now. To fill 300 beds in Nairobi is not an easy task, right? Especially with everything that is going on there right now, which is really overblown in the media. But basically, that's where loyalty programs kick in and support you and definitely come as an advantage.
Did you mentioned it, the Starwood Marriott deal. Did you know about that in advance, or was that just an added bonus?
Yeah, that was, I mean, it has its pros and its cons, but we did know about it at the time. We had heard about it, and then when you start to read the press in the West about it was going to happen, and the Chinese were going to buy Starwood and all that, and then it went back. We've taken it very positively, and we think that is definitely going to be a big advantage for us. And no, we didn't know about it at the time, but now I think it's going to work out in our favor as well.
Sure. I mean, I know you're a very involved owner, so I'm guessing you had your finger on the pulse the whole time.
Yeah, we had to watch it.
Graham as well, talking about involved owners and the whole loyalty program piece and relationships between the brands. Is there a process that you run as an owner, kind of a formalized internal process, maybe a kind of DD process when you're evaluating brands before joining up with them?
Well, kind of what we do is we identify right from the start perhaps who the operator is going to be. And we know that through the negotiation process, there are going to be a number of people that are going to pitch for the product. But we go out to our asset guys, and we get them to work through a process on each one of the brands, and which brand would ideally suit that particular property that we would be negotiating on. They would then return to me a short list as well as their summary, and then I summarize and present to our owners on who we believe the best brand would be. But as I said, normally right from the start, you know who you want in that property.
Sure. And I mean, and you don't run a kind of external formal process on this, you run it all internally, is that?
No, we go external. We go to external asset managers and we get them to investigate the brand. I think as interested as the brand is wanting to know who the owner is, the owner wants to know who the brand is.
Sure. And I mean, do you ever change your mind in the process, or is it always a kind of...
We sit with a committee at the end of the day that really takes a vote, and Huddis really has the final vote. But we'll all put our concerns forward, or we'll put our strategy forward for why we think we need to go with a particular brand. But we're normally all pretty much agreed around the table on who we should go with.
And give us an idea of some of the things that operators have to do to make themselves attractive for an owner like yourself.
Well, I think first of all, having an existing relationship helps. So those guys have already got a foot in the door. But we like to remain open-minded. We believe in multiple marriages. We don't have to simply have one brand in the family. Why not get the best out of all of these different brands, but in different products? And they don't necessarily compete with each other. They're all in different markets. And we are very mindful of that, that we don't pitch the one against the other.
Sure. And you know, one thing that I'm going to come on to, and I'm going to actually ask all of you about this, but I'm going to start with you, is the key money piece. I mean, over the last couple of days, I've heard, you know, it's something that we're seeing more and more of on franchises as well as management agreements.
But it's not a bribe.
It's not. That was where I was heading. I mean, is it essential skin in the game? Is that how you view it? Or
look,
is it,
you know, in going through the term sheets and preparing the summary, it's one of the boxes that I have to tick. And in discussions with the brand, it normally comes out right at the beginning. Or it comes out as a point that you're going to go negotiate on, or it comes out as a, we're not interested and we're not going to do it. But it's one of the things that I have to report to the owners on. So in my summary, it's there and it's a box that I have to tick. And some of the guys are quick to come right at the beginning and say, listen, we're prepared to put that key money down. And we were speaking yesterday about whether or not we actually need the key money, or whether we'd be insulted by the key money. And I would say to you that there are many ways of constructing a deal. So the key money may be at the end of the deal, or it may be elsewhere.
Sure. And I think that, you know, leading on to Maha on the same type of question, I'm guessing that's your view, as Kempinski is more in that line, right?
So yes, it is understood that the key money gives comfort to the owner, and it gives kind of, we are with you. But as you said, there are many ways to give comfort for the owners in regards to the investment. Different ways in structuring the terms and the conditions, which would make the owner comfortable. Because at the end of the day, it is a long-term relationship. It's not about the key money. For Kempinski, most of our owners are high net worth individuals who are interested in the luxury segment. They want a luxury brand. Key money is not really something that would change their mind or would influence their decision making process.
I think from an owner's point of view, when somebody comes forward and offers you key money, you think this guy is really interested in my product. So interested that he's ready to put his own money into this business.
So are you faced with operators coming forward proposing key money from the start?
and that's my thing to you, so go ahead.
I think it depends on the brand, the owner, the project, the location, all that. I think, no disrespect, but when you're building a Kempinski, I mean, what's a couple million here or there, right? But when you're in the investment game and you look at your returns and you look at your forecasts and you're building, and then the brand comes and says, oh, we need to do this way and that way, it's nice to have a big bonus at the end of the lot of blood, sweat, and tears. Now, you can call it a bribe, you can call it skin in the game. I like to look at it as the brand has the confidence in you, your product, to push it through and to also incentivize you to meet certain deadlines, timelines, and conditions. And it keeps you on your toes. So as I think it should be looked at in a positive manner.
I mean, going one step further, would it, you know, to your point, not be almost more of a commitment to do a sort of almost a JV where they invest a little bit more money? So for example, I mean, you've done a conversion recently I'm not going to ask you what it costs, but you know, for example, hypothetically, there's a hotel unbranded or branded that's a bit tired. You know, if an operator was to come and say, well, look, I'm not going to give you $500,000 to help cover systems costs. I'm going to give you $5 million, a genuine equity stake. Is that something that you'd be more interested in? Or
okay, so maybe not us ourselves, but I definitely think that would be something very keen and would help them grow. Because when you are doing these conversions, they aren't cheap to do, number one. Number two is that when you go from key money to equity, that's a game changer, because now they're in it with you. And when they're in it with you, they're in it with you on the good days, they're in it with you on the bad days. Sure. So that really shows you that these guys are really serious. And it moves on to how do you want to structure it? Do you want them in the real estate aspect of it, or do you just want them in the Manco structure? So, I mean, it depends how you structure it, but yeah, that would really, I mean, the deal closes at that point, I'd say.
Do you feel
The whole thing for me is about a relationship. We were saying yesterday that the management agreement is something that the owner should sign and then put it away, whereas it becomes the GM's Bible. And I think that's the kind of relationship you need to try and build with a brand. And you know, the fact that we are going now into our second Hilton shows us that we have confidence in that brand and we enjoy working with that brand. But we're not restricted to Hilton. We're happy to work with other brands as well. And we have Protea by Marriott as well. So our next hotel, maybe somebody else, you know. And we're not putting all our eggs in one basket.
It's a spirit of collaboration rather than a kind of legal contract. And I mean, from Maha, you know, on that collaboration piece, you know, you guys look at things differently for a number of reasons, but, you know, do you feel that there's a higher level partnership with your people, particularly in Africa, regarding the kind of corporate social piece there, the employment piece? I mean, and I'll get to the owner's side in a minute, but from a brand, I mean, do you have a sense that you're doing something that's important socially in Africa as well?
Well, whenever a luxury operator enters a new market, it will have an impact on the local communities. And for Kempinski, we try as much as we can to make this impact as positive as possible. From job creation, from training, from empowerment to the of the local workforce, this is part of our DNA. I will give you the example of our Kempinski Hotel in Accra, where we have 415 employees and 96% of the workforce is Ghanaian. And this is key, again, because this is part of what we stand for. We train, we empower, and we create jobs. And for Africa, the hospitality financial impact is big, is important.
Yeah, I mean, we are, you know, it was discussed earlier with Stephen and Jonathan, this kind of McKinsey stat of the number of people that are going to be unemployed by the industry in the future. But, you know, we're fortunate in a way, I guess, that in Africa we're still kind of behind the curve on the automation. I mean, we may jump it, we may not. But from an owner's perspective now, and this is to both of you in whichever order you...
A big plus for us when you go in and you look at the operator is whether or not they have an e-learning platform. Your employee comes into your hotel at a very basic skill level, and you're looking for this brand to grow that employee. So that's very important to us. Equally as important is the buy-in to social responsibility in the local community, and all the brands we work with buy into that kind of thing. So,
yeah, just add on to Graham's point. We look at training, you look at growth, you look at how can this we believe in a ground-up approach. So how does this employee go from being a busboy to being a waiter to being, I mean, restaurant manager and so on? So this is where I think these brands come in and really can lay down rules and platforms in markets across Africa and show us the way forward.
And I mean, surely there's also incentives, you see, or potential incentives from governments to create so many jobs. And
yeah, so I'm not sure how it works in many other countries in Africa, but just to give an insight into Kenya, I see some very experienced Kenyan hotel owners in the room, so I don't mean to bore them, but in Kenya, if you are building a hotel, you're coming in with dollar inflows. If you're coming in with dollar inflows, you can make a case to the Ministry of Tourism and the government to say that I'm going to be creating X amount of jobs and directly, and I'm going to create X amount of jobs indirectly, and this is the level of investment that's going in, and so on, and they will actually try and work with you to save you on certain import duties of stuff that cannot be manufactured locally. They'll help you in other sort of tax breaks if they're available. I know in Rwanda there's similar schemes as well. But definitely, I think when you're going in with heavy investment and you're going in to create jobs, I think many of these governments are willing to sit down at a table and talk about it.
Is that the case with you?
Yeah, the government exactly the same. In Namibia, we have rebate on training that we can claim back, which is very important to us. So that's what I said earlier, in having an e-learning platform is of benefit to us as an owner. We were talking yesterday as well about how the employees are jumping between different hotels and how you train them and then they leave you. What is good with a multiple brand is I see a lot of our employees leaving the one brand and joining the other brand on the other side. So where you kind of say to the GM, I'm sorry to see the employee go there, we're very happy to welcome him in on the other side, you know, so to your benefit as well.
Absolutely. And I mean, in your experience, do the brands get involved in understanding what incentives are provided, you know, by whichever market they're entering, or is it more a kind of onus on the owner to kind of understand the local legislation? I mean, is that being used by the brands as a differentiator?
I think if the brand is new to the country, they rely a lot on the owner, and that's why I think it's very important for the brand as well to select the right partner, especially somebody who's got a foothold in the country and understands how the country works. So I think we help the brand in that respect.
And actually, I totally agree with you, Graham. It is very important from the beginning to have a local partner who's strong. We have the example of in many of our properties where we have local partners who actually helped us open many, many, many doors because they have the experience, they have the know-how, and they have been operating in these countries for a very long time. Coming back to the employees and the training, of course this is key, and the first thing that would come to my mind is our operation in Djibouti, in the Djibouti Palace, where I believe, I'm not sure, but I think we are one of the biggest private employer in the whole country, and of course this is very well received by the government.
Absolutely. And I mean, do you, from an owner's perspective, when you choose a partner, because it is really more of a partnership on the Kempinski basis, I mean, does that play a part in it? How do you vet your local owners? I'm guessing they need to impress you as well.
Well, again, it's a marriage. So it's a long-term marriage. Everything has to be aligned and discussed in the open and be clear about it, because one of the things that is also very important is to understand the asset strategy of the owner. What is his vision? And if this is not aligned from the beginning, then it would be bound to fail.
Yeah, no, sorry, I'd have to agree with Maha completely that some of these contracts last longer than many marriages in some cases, right? So you have to go into this eyes wide open. You have to know that what you're getting into is not that easy to get out of, and most importantly is that you're stuck with each other for the next however many years.
20, 30.
Yeah, you never know. I'm not going to disclose that figure, but that's how many years it does take. And you really have to be able to maintain good relations with these people, and you need them. You really need them in good times and bad, especially.
No, sure. And I think it was Scott who asked the question in the previous session.
Yeah.
About Accor and how their strategy may change over that period.
Correct.
However, you are still running the same property. You're paying money into them, and they've changed their strategy. They may not be focusing on promoting your type of property, although that's the initial reason that you made that decision.
So I think keeping the owner informed as well and consulting with the owners on a regular basis is going to help you down the line. I mean, as you were saying, it's like a marriage, and now and again you get the 7-year itch.
Yeah.
And hopefully it goes away, and normally it does go away. But if you have that relationship with a brand, you can sort these kind of things out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Involve owners in your strategy a little bit more might be something that comes out of this, hopefully. I think.
So, sorry, can I just add on to just about? As an owner, I'm allowed to vent a bit about brands, but I think it's very, very important that these brands talk to their owners in the regions. I'll give you a very good example. In Nairobi, we have 2 4 points by Sheratons. Marriott is putting up a JW Marriott across Nairobi, which is targeting a completely different market, different segment. That works because they can sit down with you and tell you, this is our strategy, this is who we're talking to, this is not who we're talking to. And you feel part of the family. You feel like, okay, they're not really asking me for permission, but they're kind of telling me what's going on, so I'm not shot in the dark. This is something I think brands really, really, really need to take advantage of and have that sort of mutual respect with their owners, because, I mean, it could go sour over one or two properties, and that's that.
Yeah, it's true.
I think that's a good point. Sorry, Margaret.
So I would agree with you, Shamil. And at Kempinski, again, because we are a small brand and we only have one brand, and we also have decentralized most of our functions. So out of Dubai, we have the full regional office, which is looking only out for around 20 properties. So full regional team with all the specialists focusing on only 20 properties. Which is, of course, having a very big impact on the operational and financial performance of the hotels.
No, I mean, it's, you know, in the job I do, I spend a lot of time with people like Shamil and with the operators and the owners. And it's invaluable to have those relationships with the owners because you understand the market better. So, I mean, I'm not sure how much it's being done at the moment, but you seem like a great resource for operators to come and talk to understand a market when they build their strategy. And, you know, it does seem sometimes that they're building these strategies and these portfolios without necessarily spending much time with the local owners that are obviously on their side.
Yeah, they what I've tended to see in at least Kenya, which was a hot market until, I mean, still is a lot of the brands will have, I mean, somebody will write them an email and say, oh, I have a nice piece of land in X, Y, and Z, and it turns out to be a good location. But does that individual have the capacity to pull that off? Does he have the financial resources? Does he have all this for you to sort of jeopardize a relationship with another owner in that region or play against it? The other thing is, sorry, just to add on, is many of the brands have multiple different versions of the same brands. If you they were talking about Ibis and Ibis Styles and all that. If it might not make sense. It might make sense in the Western world to have multiple of those in a single city, but I'm not sure if Africa is ready for that just yet. So it'd also be good for brands to sort of have that mature discussion as well.
Sure, and they probably do, but I mean, I think, you know, one thing we've been asked to do recently by an owner in East Africa is take a look at the brand landscape of a couple of cities in 5 years' time before they then, you know, it's an independent owner, before they then join up with the brand and then say, look, where is the gap going to be in 5 years from a brand perspective, and which brand should we be talking to, which I think is a really interesting exercise. And it's probably something that operators should be looking at as well.
What we find in our part of the world is that everybody understands the core brand. They may not necessarily understand the Courtyard or whatever, but it ends up being called the Hilton or the Marriott or whatever. Correct. It's just the way it is.
Sure, yeah. Or if it was called Hilton, it becomes a Marriott, it's still called the Hilton. The Holiday Inn in Nairobi, for example. And I mean, just, you know, I know we're running out of time and I want to ask a couple of questions or open up for a couple of questions. But just summarizing the last couple of days, this is more to the owners, Maha, I'm sorry, but, you know, any brands in particular the last couple of days that you've seen anything interesting, different coming out of that you know, you'd mention? I mean, has anybody really impressed you?
Yes or no? I mean, you've got to act not interested as you walk past the stand. You know, okay. We're always shopping, you know.
Sure.
And I guess they're taking the same attitude with the owners as well. But yes, there's one or two things I've seen since I've been here that I would like to bring to our part of the world. And I'm sure we'll get into negotiations or discussions with the guys shortly.
So you are seeing positive changes? There is a difference to last year and the year before, and things are moving in the right direction.
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Shamil, yourself?
I haven't had much of a chance, but I have seen some of the presentations this morning of the new brands that are coming up. I can't remember the name, sorry, beginning with L. But I thought his presentation was actually, because I'm technically a millennial, I thought that is a very interesting way to push hotels. It's very Soho House. It's definitely something that I think will do well and not that I'm overly, sorry, what was the word used? But I'm not too eager right now, but maybe in the future.
I mean, Kempinski's unique.
Yeah.
So they're different. But I think, you know, we've got a minute or two, and if anybody wants to ask any questions of any of the panelists, then I think we've got a mic roaming around. So, no? Fantastic. That's very Swiss. 30 seconds early. So thank you very much. Thanks a lot, guys.